my focus is on nanotechnology and a particular subset of nanotechnology called nanophotonics, which deals with how light interacts with materials on the nanoscale. And what I'd like to share with you today is how light might just be the next handy reagent for pharmaceuticals and agrochemicals. Now, before we dive into the nitty-gritty details of nanophotonics, I wanted to share with you a picture of two snails that I found mating outside my apartment about a year ago. These snails are a beautiful example of chirality, a word that derives from the Greek word for hand. As you can see, each snail shell has a certain twist associated with it, in this case, a right-handed spiral. And intriguingly, this twist propagates all the way down through to the internal organs of the snail, meaning that a right-handed snail is literally only a good fit for another right-handed snail. So if you tend to find these little guys clustering together, they're all going to be dominated by exclusively one-handedness in their snail colony. Now, in nature, there are many molecules that, like the snail shell, have a certain handedness associated with it. These include molecules like DNA, which in nature is always right-handed, and sugars like glucose, which also in nature are exclusively right-handed, and also amino acids, the building blocks of proteins, which are exclusively left-handed. Now, this homochirality of nature, the fact that we don't find naturally made DNA that's left-handed or naturally made amino acids that are right-handed, is perhaps one of life's greatest mysteries, and one that we as chemists in the lab haven't been quite as good at reproducing. In fact, if you turn to a typical laboratory synthesis of a molecule, in this case I'm showing you limonene, it turns out you wind up making mixtures of both-handed molecules. So here's a molecule for those of you who don't remember your organic chemistry classes. Basically, each vertex of the hexagon that you see up there corresponds to a carbon-hydrogen bond. And you can imagine if you were making this molecule and you just needed to add on that last hydrogen where you can see kind of the bonds coming out, it has an equal probability of going to the right or to the left. And it turns out if that hydrogen goes to the right-hand side, then this molecule smells like oranges. But if it goes to the left-hand side, then the molecule smells like pine. And we wind up making equal mixtures of both in a typical organic synthesis of this particular molecule, which has a non-superimposable mirror image. Now, thinking about smells is kind of a fun example, but it turns out that many agrochemicals and pharmaceuticals also have a certain handedness associated with it. And this was actually brought to prominence in the late 1960s when the drug thalidomide was first marketed in Europe to treat morning nausea in pregnant women. It turns out that if you look at the mirror image that's non-superimposable in thalidomide, it actually induced birth defects, and in 50% of all cases, fetal death. So a pretty catastrophic example that really brought to the forefront in the world, and especially in the United States, the importance of testing the effects of these molecules that seemingly are identical but are non-superimposable mirror images of each other. Now, if you look to the current agrochemical and pharmaceutical industry, roughly about 50% of drugs and 40% of agrochemicals are chiral, meaning that they have a certain handedness associated with it. And of those, more than 90% are sold as mixtures of both-handed molecules. And that's because it's so hard to separate them. They have the same atomic constituents, meaning they have the same weight, they have the same electronic charge, so it's really challenging to come up with ways to separate them. And these would include, for example, the drug Advil. Who here has taken Advil? How long does it take for pain relief? Yeah, I'm hearing about 20, 30 minutes. That's absolutely right. And that's because the wrong-handed molecule essentially interferes with the action of the appropriate molecule that could bind with our cellular receptors that generally also have a certain handedness associated with it. So if it were sold as a pure, single-handed drug, it would only take about 8 minutes for pain relief. Also, the antidepressant Prozac is sold as a mixture of both-handed molecules where the wrong-handed molecule can induce migraines and heart palpitations. And also in a number of agrochemicals like herbicides and pesticides, the wrong-handed molecule can leave residues in soil, giving rise to colony collapse in bees, and in some cases, organ failure in birds, fish, and larger mammals. So what my lab is trying to do is figure out if we can use light to separate enantiomers. Why light? Well, of course, it's a renewable resource, it's very abundant, and it turns out you can also make light into a chiral structure. So light, for those of you who want to go back to your Physics 41 classes, is an oscillating electric and magnetic field in space and in time. And essentially, you can come up with a simple way of polarizing light so that its electric field, which I'm showing here, traces out a helix in time. So here you can see that we have a right-handed spiral. And the idea basically is that you take this right-handed helix of chiral light, and essentially it should hopefully initiate an optical handshake with your right-handed molecule, so that way you can physically separate the right-handed from the left-handed molecule. The problem is that the wavelength, the visible light, which is a wavelength or energy of light that is not going to damage your molecules, is too big to interact strongly with molecules. So most molecules have dimensions on the order of just one or a few nanometers or even less, whereas the wavelength of visible light that we can see is about 400 to 700 nanometers. So what we have to do is shrink the wavelength of light down. We do so by using what I call here a nano-coaxial optical fiber. It's a lot like the coax that you would plug into the back of your cable TV. It has a metallic core, a metallic cladding, and a dielectric ring. In this case, that ring is just going to be air or water. And then we'll have our chiral molecules above it. And the idea is that if we had an array of these nano-coaxial optical fibers, we could illuminate it with circularly polarized light, and the right-handed enantiomer would basically be pulled toward right circularly polarized light, passing through that air-water channel, enabling physical separation of the enantiomers. And each of those coaxes essentially acts to shrink down the wavelength of light without changing its energy by virtue of exciting something called surface plasmons. That's probably for lecture number two, maybe later on this afternoon. Okay, so can we make these structures? Yes, we can, using state-of-the-art nanofabrication. Here you can see a zoom-in of just one of the coaxial channels. It looks kind of like a bullseye grating. The grating turns out to just boost the amount of light that's getting through each aperture. And if we zoom into that air channel, you can see the thickness is just about 50 nanometers across, so much smaller than the wavelength of light that's impeding upon it. It's about 2,000 times smaller than the width of a human hair, and 5 or 10 times smaller than a typical virus. So we're squeezing light into pretty small dimensions, but it's still large enough to allow the molecules to pass through. And now if we calculate the forces that a molecule would feel when light is impinging upon it, here's the pulling force as a function of x and y. You can see for right circularly polarized light, if we have a right-handed molecule above it, basically there's a uniformly strong pulling force. And you'll remember that force is a vector. It has a certain direction associated with it. And in this case, the molecule is always going to be pulled towards that coaxial channel, so that way it can get pushed down to the other side of the filter. Now, if we look at a right or a left-handed molecule, you can see that the force is much weaker. And it turns out to actually be repulsive, so that left-handed molecule will get pushed away from this all-optical filter. So the first thing we wanted to do is characterize these forces. You can see that the pulling forces are 2.5 piconewtons. That's about 100 billion times smaller than the force you exert when you're typing a text message to your friends to say, hey, I'm at the Stanford reunion. So again, we have to turn to nanotechnology to enable us just to characterize the forces to make sure we can efficiently separate molecules. And we do so using a technique called atomic force microscopy. You can think of this technique as essentially having a diving board or a cantilever that has your chiral structure at the end. And all we're essentially doing is monitoring the deflection of the cantilever as it's moving across our sample. So that chiral structure could be, for example, a molecule. For visualization purposes here, I'm showing you another chiral structure that we've just patterned at the end of our atomic force microscope tip. Here, just a chiral spiral. So you can see when we turn the light on that the pulling force goes up compared to when the light is off. And if we map this pulling force over just a quadrant of our coaxial aperture with extremely high resolution, up to atomic scale resolution, you can see that the pulling force when we have right circularly polarized light is much stronger when we have the right-handed enantiomer compared to the left-handed enantiomer. And now if we look at all separations between the chiral nanostructure and the coaxial optical fiber, here's the lateral force. It's pretty close to what we predicted theoretically, on the order of 4 to 6 piconewtons. And you can see that for the left-handed structure, it's entirely repulsive, whereas for the right-handed structure, it's entirely attractive. So we're using this now to separate pharmaceutically relevant drugs like Advil. And in many ways, this plot is kind of the crux of my talk, showing that light may indeed be the next handy reagent to separate enantiomers. You can think about this as light initiating an optical handshake with the right-handed molecule, or if you prefer, going back to our snails, a little optical smooch, hopefully enabling a healthier planet and a healthier population. Thank you so much for your time.